Coxed Four, and congratulations to you all, a marvellous performance. Andy Holmes, it must have been an enormous thrill.
It certainly was, and a big relief, big relief. We knew we were capable of it after the heat on Monday when we won it quite easily. The last week has just been absolute torture waiting for it, and this is it. We went out and did it.
Richard Budgett, what has it meant to you?
Well, it's a culmination of 4 years. I've been building up to this since 1981, I suppose, and all that training and hard work's finally culminated in what must be the ultimate triumph for a sportsman, a gold medal at the Olympics. It's just unbelievable.
Adrian Ellison, if I can come down to you, you must have been just a little bit concerned when you saw the pace that was being set for you.
We were concerned, but we knew that we could take them back. If they were going to be ahead of us at any stage in the race, it would mean that they'd been pushing hard to do so. And we knew that we'd got a fast finish and we could take anybody who was on the water.
Stephen Redgrave, can I just lean across to you? You were dicing at one time with the single sculls rather than the four. You presumably don't regret the decision now?
Not now, no.
Thanks, Steve.
Yeah. What about the rest of these lads? What have they done for you?
That's putting me on the spot. No, we've had a good time. We've had a few laughs in the 3 months we've been together. And it's been very enjoyable.
And can I talk to Martin Cross? Your parents and sister were here. Have you seen them since?
Yes, so I actually rushed over to my dad just after the medal ceremony. It's quite an emotional moment, and I think they've enjoyed themselves quite a lot out here.
Well, congratulations to you all from us and from everybody back home. Well done.
Thank you very much.
Cheers.
That was quicker than I remember it. He just went bosh, bosh, bosh down the line, didn't he?
What was Andy in his underpants for?
Do you remember that? My daughter's still got that. She's got those shorts in her. She wears them as sleepwear.
Yeah. I've still got that T-shirt and that sartorial hat. I'm amazed it didn't catch on, Martin.
So does that seem like a long time ago? Or quite recently.
Fucking hell! Can't say that. Sorry.
That'll be the first beep.
Yeah.
First of many.
I think
in some ways it feels like very, very long time ago, and yet in other ways it seems like it was only a month or so. It's really weird. Very, very different emotions about it all. That's from my perspective, anyway.
I think the other thing is we've all aged, apart from Steve, we've all aged quite well. But so
I just looked like this then.
Yeah, I think so. It doesn't feel. We did the 30th anniversary, didn't we? A few years. It doesn't seem like 6 years. Was it 6 years since we did the 30th anniversary at Henley?
Mm-hmm. Good maths.
It doesn't seem like that, and it doesn't seem like that's 36 years ago. That seems like an age.
Yeah. I remember talking to you had a reunion and a road pass, did you, at Henley, did you?
Yeah, we had Mike in the three seat, and I think he thought we should have had him in the three seat for the 84 games instead of Andy.
And the annoying thing was he rode longer than we did.
Yeah, that's right. He was shoving it down as well, wasn't he?
You know what Mark's like. He was training for that for months.
Yeah, yeah. And he wanted to go on longer, didn't he? I remember.
I think Andy
go right way down to the start and row up the whole course.
Yeah.
So I guess the one person who's not here is Andy. I mean, I never got to meet Andy, but he's obviously a big part of the crew. So what did he bring to the crew? In 84.
Who's going to start with that one?
Yeah.
In some ways, that we were all very different characters. And Andy was certainly out there, very, very quiet. We all, at different times, didn't want to row with each other for various different reasons. And that Andy just sort of kept himself to himself. And that under Mike's guidance and training, that he really became a very solid, compact athlete. And when he was motivated to do something, he was incredible. sometimes it was hard to get him motivated. And within our group of working towards the 84 Olympics, he was very motivated. But there were times, and this is why some people didn't want to row with him, is that he was in an eight going to one of the world championships, trained all winter, and decided it wasn't fast enough, so didn't turn up at the airport as they were going to the first international regatta. I rode with him probably longer than anyone else did out of this group. And I never had any problems with him at all. He was always on training on time, always pretty motivated. Every now and again, you'd get a phone call and saying, I'm going to be late for training because I'm doing my house up and the boiler's blown up or whatever. he would then have a sort of a miss a session from that point of view. But we got on pretty well together, even though it was documented pretty well that we didn't. We only had a fight once, and I think that was in the early 80s at the Ely gym, where we used to play football, and both of us can't play football. And the ball went into the corner, and we went in swinging our legs about. The ball came out, and we were still then not swinging our legs, but swinging our arms around at each other for some reason. That was the only time that we really had any conflict with each other.
That's amazing.
Andy, he used to have a rep. He was in that four in 81, that Kingston four that led the world for, 1,200 metres or something like that.
Well,
he had a reputation as someone who really front-loaded races.
Mm-hmm.
And it was quite interesting that when we got together as a four, the reputation that we had was actually that we were strong in the finisher races. Particularly in the games, but he was a fearsome trainer. So he, the story of him, I don't know if it's apocryphal, but he had this double sized hod that he worked as a brickie, and he would have a double sized hod because you got paid more than anyone else on site. So he could, sort of leg more bricks up the ladder. So I always had an impression of him as really tough, and tough in more than just the rowing sense. But he was quite sensitive too. I mean, he did a French degree. He used to read French literature, and I remember out in LA we went looking for a sort of number plate, didn't we? He used to drive a Cadillac.
Cadillac Breakers Yard.
I don't know if we ever got one.
That was in San Diego, wasn't it?
Oh, was it San Diego?
Yeah. It's an unusual souvenir, but I remember him looking for that.
What was he like to row behind Budge? Because you were on bow side with him, weren't you?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, he was so determined, as you say, in both physically and mentally, certainly during that time that we were together in the four. So, that gave you just complete confidence there was someone you could totally rely on in that racing. So, I remember that, but also just how, as you were saying earlier, we're all so different. And I remember, was it Richard Burnell in the Times who labelled us the unlikely lads in an article? Yeah. So we got these T-shirts printed. I can't remember. I think it was you, Adrian, or Crossy who got them printed with the unlikely lads. And we wore them at the race at Henley. And that was quite fun.
Wouldn't happen now.
So it's quite a big deal. Wasn't it? Because you guys were the first time that it was like a squad system, wasn't it? Because before then it was club crews, and 84 was the first time they really put like unlikely people together.
I remember fighting tooth and nail, really. I was such an arsey, guy then.
Really? You used to be.
I'm not anymore. I'm nice now. I've really weathered. I've weathered. So, but I fought tooth and nail against that squad system. The whole of that winter. I think that was the winter that tried to found the International Rowers and Sculler's Club to protest against Penny putting the squad, making a squad system. And so I had this real sort of struggle. We had meetings at, I think it was a carnival in school. We had like a 70 or 80 or 100 rowers come for the inaugural meeting. It was all to no avail. But I think part of it was that we had this thing in the winter of we were all, Steve was in the single And then Budge was rowing with Tom in a pair. Andy was with Whipper, Paul Wensley. Yeah. And I was with John Beattie. And we used to just knock the hell out of each other the whole, that's what I remember, the whole winter in pairs. So I took my frustrations out on the water. But it was an incredibly hard winter racing each other.
And where did you rate each other? Normal head races, or did you set trials?
We were at Thorpe a lot, weren't we?
Yeah.
At Thorpe Water Park.
Yeah. That was mainly sort of spring and early summer in 84. We were at Thorpe all the time, but Mike had us doing, what was the length of it, 1,500 metres or 1,250? Just again and again and again with all the boats kind of side by side and racing against each other at fixed rates all the time. So it was very, very competitive. And I think because of that, everybody developed a sort of grudging feeling of respect for each other, which kind of wasn't there to start with. Because like Martin said, you know, nobody wanted to row with each other to start with.
But when
four was put together, it was quite an interesting evolution how that happened over that training camp in Sabaudia Easter.
The other thing, Adrian, is that we were all, because we were in the Cox Fours group, we got the sort of tag of people who couldn't row. You know, like the eights group were all nice and smooth and just like, you know, and we were the Cox Four, the dinosaurs.
Have you seen the video?
Up and rough.
Of what?
Yeah. We'll watch the four in a minute. Watch the race in a bit.
Yeah. The Americans are much smoother than we are. That's for certain. That's Sabaudia trip, because I was only allowed to go on that Sabaudia trip if I committed myself to rowing the four at one of the international regattas.
I never knew that.
Yeah, no, that was the only reason that Penny would allow me to go, that if I would race at Mannheim on one of the days. And so I was there on my single. And there's two things I remember about that camp. Neither of them about me, but was that Mike used to play little games all the time because of the conflict between the group. And one of his ploys was that he asked all the group, apart from me that was in the single, to write down the names of the people that they thought was the best four. And his theory behind it was that everyone's always going to put themselves in it, and then they will put the three next best people in there, which everybody did, apart from one, Crossy, who didn't put himself in the four, put himself in a Cox's pair with John Beattie. And it sort of scuppered Mike's plans on that one. And then the other one is that you raced in Cox pairs.
Yeah, and that's a good story.
And of Tom and Budge fell out, and Andy went up to, it's a huge lake, middle of nowhere. Andy went up to them and got Adrian to swim up to the bows to change the lane numbers because you had a better lane than they did.
And then I remember that. Yeah, the rigger broke, so we fell in. And Paul.
No, you've got a crap.
No, we were doing not.
We were doing a standing start and you caught a crab on about the second stroke. And I remember, you know how quickly you think? You think so much more quickly than you can talk. The night before, I'd been talking with Woody, who was the other Cox in that group, who was much more experienced than me. And we were talking about the design of these Cox pair boats that we were using, which were basically converted Cox-less pairs. So the Cox had virtually no cockpit room to get in or out of the boat. You had to slide in really into a very confined space. And I remember as the boat is starting to fill up with water, I remember this conversation with Woody basically saying, if one of these boats turns over, that's it, you're going to drown. You can't possibly get out. And I remember being there, watching the water coming in over the gunwale, and like it happened in slow motion, and I'm thinking, I'm not going to get out of this. We're going to go over and I'm going to drown. And then the next thing I know, I sort of pop out of it, God knows how, and I find that the other two are both there. Tom had got his feet stuck in the boat and he was sort of panicking a little bit about that. And it turned out he dislocated his thumb as well. But yeah, it's just one of those weird things. And then the next thing I know, as Steve says, the other pair, which is Andy and Paul Wensley with Woody steering them, come over and we think they're going to rescue us. And Andy turns around and says, we need your bow number.
That's how single-minded he was. He was only interested in what was going to benefit of him. And they did pretty well in the race. Didn't they win that race?
I think they won it.
They won it. We won the pairs. You must have won the singles. I did. In fact, you had a decent skull. It's interesting that to hear from you. I'm not sure I've ever heard the story from you about Mannheim, because we raced the Saturday with John Beattie at Mannheim, and we just got through the last year's silver medalist, the West Germans, on the line, and we won. So it was like, oh right, that's great, you know. And then you raced Colby and Carpina, and I think came third behind them. But yeah. I what was it like for you coming in the four? Because you made such an impact. It was like, absolutely, I kind of want to almost swear to put some, you know, ahead of it. It was incredible, really.
I think you promoted the West Germans, haven't you? Weren't they fourth place?
Well, I'd look on the FISA website.
No, I think Kiwis won. I thought the Russians were in there because we raced the Russians at Essen.
Yeah, we did.
And I think that the West Germans were fourth or maybe third. Not totally sure on that. But, yeah, I remember I was obviously concentrating on the single, and I was pretty pleased with the result that I had behind Carpine and Colby. Obviously, you were all excited with the result that you had. And I remember walking back into the barracks with Andy, and Andy said to me, he said, oh, we've just had a fantastic row. We're never going to do any better than that. That was just fantastic. And to be honest, I wasn't too worried about the four at all. I'd done what I wanted to do in the single. Well, I wanted to beat one of them. I did in the heat, but not in the final. And so as my arrangements with Penny, I rode in the four the next day. John Beattie went out of the bow seat. Martin went into the bow seat, and I came into the stroke seat. And we just sort of disappeared into the distance right away from the start. But I remember very clearly of coming into the last 750 metres. Because normally in the single, I'd be absolutely exhausted and hanging on for grim death.
Yeah.
And thinking, God, 750 to go. Is that all? I can push again, and I'm able to push on again. So the difference between a faster moving boat and a slower moving boat, the race finishes a lot quicker.
I remember you. We did a practice start that evening. And I remember going into Bowser. I remember hanging on for dear life, because it was like you. I don't know if you were doing this, but you know, I'm going to show those bastards, because the start was phenomenal. It was just like nothing like I'd experienced before. And then we obviously reprised that in the race the next day, as you said. And the Germans who we rode through, they were like toast at 500 meters gone or 300 meters gone.
Yeah,
and it was like
the day before by rowing them down the line.
But so that it's interesting, because did Mike say then, right, Steve, this is it, the four? Because obviously the four's good. Or did Penny say to you, how did it go? Because I've just assumed it all happened seamlessly.
What happened from there is that obviously the good result in the four, but that's why I think that the Germans were fourth place, because they were just out of the medals, and that's why I committed myself to for the next 2 weeks to go to Essen, because we knew that there would be a stronger competition there with the Russians being there. I think everyone felt that I'd done a good enough performance in the single to justify carrying on in the single.
Yeah.
Obviously, it was a boycott year. It hadn't been finalised at that time that the boycott was going to happen. And that in those 2 weeks between Mannheim and Essen, I was sort of thinking, okay, that if I'm going to stay in the single, you've got a West German and a Finnish guy. They're not going to be boycotted. But the top players in the Cox Four were Eastern Bloc.
Yeah.
And so that I thought for my long-term aim to be a single scull winning a single scull gold medal in Seoul in 88 is that of having an Olympic gold medal around your neck, that was going to help me in sponsorship and the process of getting there. So it was very, very selfish of looking at it. And then once we raced, if you remember, in awful conditions at Essen, the conditions got worse as they went down, not quite as bad as Grinnell when we went for another regatta. I'll let Budge tell that story of where we had to empty the boat before that regatta. But we beat the Russians very convincingly, I think by about a length. And so that sort of put us in sort of the frame of potentially being gold medalists. And then it was a relatively easy decision to say that Mike, yes, I had conversations with Mike. Penny wasn't really involved in it at all on those conversations. But I sort of come around to myself being very selfish, single sculler of the longer view at it. It wasn't until about 5 or 6 years ago that I realized I was a rubbish single sculler I was a better team player than I was being on my own. And needed people around me to get the best out of me.
Bloody hell, you might have picked up a bronze medal that year in the Olympics. I can't. Was it Hans Svensson who won the bronze that year?
No.
Who won the bronze?
He was Canadian.
Oh God, yeah. What was his name? Can't remember.
Come on, Crossy. I can't remember.
You're famous for encyclopedic knowledge.
Was that?
Porter's later. Yeah. All right. That's one we have to remember.
Anyway, going back to Essen, this is a bit of a pattern that's emerging here. But do you remember in the final Essen, somebody's rigger broke, and we still managed to win.
Oh yeah, we rode in the impact.
It was a smooth power that was being put through the rigger.
Yeah, wasn't that a brand new boat as well? The first time we raced in it.
We took the Janicek out and then we had a new M-Packer on the trailer and Mike said, which one do you want to race in? And we all said M-Packer.
Yeah, looked very nice boat, didn't it?
Yeah, and then four of the five of us spent quite a long time rigging that boat up. And somebody was off talking to all his mates.
What, me?
What, you?
That was, yeah. I did like talking to a lot of people, actually. And
did you ever rig a boat at an international regatta?
I think I might have gone to get a rigger or something and been a long time getting back or taking the blades down and been, yeah, you're right. Must have pissed people off that.
Just a little.
Yeah.
Sorry.
It wasn't as bad as your kickback.
No, that was, yeah, that was awful.
Gross.
I think we should talk about the kickback, actually. I think that's a good idea.
No, don't talk about the kickback. Okay. And don't talk about
you turn up to
the airport with a kickback.
Yeah.
Oh, with a bomb in it. Yeah. Or with a screwdriver. Oh, that was 82, wasn't it? That was, That was what about Grunau? Because that was quite cool going to East Germany and going through the wall at Checkpoint Charlie.
Yeah. And then I remember is when we were warming up for the race and we filled up with water and you saw a beach, didn't you, Adrian, that we could empty the boat at. And as we rowed towards the beach, you started laughing and none of us knew why until we got there and realized it was a nudist beach.
I got very embarrassed.
It was after we'd had to swerve to avoid a deer swimming across the river on the way to the start.
Yeah.
And then the boat filled up with water. So I'm lying there being half drowned as the water's sloshing backwards and forwards over me. And all that you guys can hear through the microphone. So you're all laughing your heads off as well. And then we go to this beach to empty it out, and it turns out to be a nudist beach. So we emptied the boat out and got back into it and rowed straight back to the start, which was probably only about 500 meters away, maybe a K. And by the time we got attached on the start, the boat was full of water again.
Yeah.
did we row with dry zackers or because
no.
with
very yeah, short East German blades?
We couldn't adjust the gearing right at all.
No.
Now, whether that was deliberate or not, they'd given us a boat with non-adjustable gearing. We never knew, but it wasn't suitable.
So why did you go to Grunau then? What was the decision to do that?
It was a political thing, wasn't it? It was so that we could race the Eastern Bloc, because I think the boycott had just been announced a little bit beforehand, and we weren't sure whether they were going to go to Lucerne. So I think both Penny and Mike together probably put together this plan that in order to race the best in the world, we needed to go to them. So we were given special permission to go to Grunau, and we were the first British crew for years and years that had been allowed through.
Yeah.
I think that meant more to you, Martin, than it did to all of us, because, of course, you were a history teacher.
Yeah.
And you got very excited about the Berlin Wall and everything.
More excited about the vodka party with the Pimenovs afterwards.
Did we stay the night in East Berlin?
Or did we come?
Yeah,
we were in that hotel, weren't we? We've been watched by the Stasi all the time, but we were in
we had a minder. East
Berlin hotel.
Yeah, it was interesting because it was rough water. We never beat the East there, though, did we? Which I kind of always put down to the fact we had a borrowed boat and borrowed blades.
I think you're right, because we then raced in Lucerne and they came to Lucerne. Do you remember in Lucerne that Mike told us if we won on the Saturday, then we could have the day off on the Sunday? And I found that highly motivational. I don't know about the rest of
it. I've never forgiven him for that.
Have you not? How come? Because
we broke
the world record.
and we held the world record for not even 24 hours. And the whole field the next day went 2 seconds quicker.
Yeah. Yeah. That race at Lucerne on the Saturday, I remember we had a conversation, Steve, about the time. You asked me what time we thought we'd do. And I was going about 6:11 or something, 6:12. And we came down and it was 6:07.98. And I remember we got through the East. We'd led the East, didn't we? I remember coming through in the third 500. I remember the water being very green and being ahead of the East and looking back. And I'd been beaten so many times by East Germans at Lucerne and thinking, you know, bloody hell, this is what it feels like to be good, just out in front. It was just a phenomenal row that we'd had that day on the Saturday at Lucerne.
Yeah.
So you guys suddenly winning all this stuff, you know, and you said, Martin, the Eastern Europe bloc countries have been dominating stuff for quite a while. Was it a shock? Were you comfortable? Was it just really fun?
It was a bit of a whirlwind, as I remember, is that there was so much happening with the boycott happening of the disruptor of the group through the winter, of not quite sure what was going to be happening and what we would do, and then going out and racing and beating the best in the world, or going out and trying to find the best in the world to race them and being able to do it almost in our stride.
I just remember it being fun. The whole experience was just tremendous fun for me.
What about Mannheim?
I remember when we first got Mannheim together. Was that,
going back from Mannheim, how fun was that?
Do you remember it, Adrian?
Going back, I don't remember at all.
Oh, yeah.
The day after was not fun at all.
They wouldn't let you on the plane, would they?
No, I said he had food. I said, look, I'm a doctor. He's got food poisoning. And then they looked after you really well, and you were first on the plane, special treatment.
For those of you that
I remember when you put my head up,
of course, that was the story. After we raced, is that we had a few beers, And Adrian being a bit smaller than the rest of it affected him a little bit more than us. And I can remember of Dr. Budgett taking it upon himself to look after Adrian and took him into the toilets in the airport to make him drink water and shoved him under the tap. And all you could hear is Adrian with his watery voice again that he was in Grinnell, saying, it's hot water.
Oh, dear.
So, yeah, the next thing I knew is I woke up in the back of Rusty's car in England.
So then you basically raced Lucerne, and so at that point you'd beaten everybody, and then obviously Eastern Bloc didn't go to LA. So you went as favourites to LA, which no British crew had been a favourite for a very long time.
Yeah. It wasn't quite as simple as that, because there was a Kiwi crew that we hadn't raced. And I think we heard that they were based on the previous year's gold medal crew that was one of the outstanding crews in Duisburg in the World Championships in 83. And there was also a new American crew who had beaten the American crew that we had raced two or three times in Europe. And we'd beaten them every time, but, you know, not by enormous amounts. So they then went back to America and they had to do trials.
I think I remember that, you know, feeling after that win in Lucerne, pretty confident that we were the crew to beat, and it was quite a long build up. That it was very exciting because we kind of went out to training camp in San Diego, but because we were on this really odd sort of regime, that we go to bed at 7 and get up at 3 in the morning and then, you know, go training before the sun came up almost. It kind of felt like we were special, particularly compared to the rest of the team. So I always felt like we were a special boat, I think, from what we'd done in the season and for the people we had in it, really. And that sort of training camp confirmed it. So I can't remember worrying about the New Zealanders, and I never worried about the Americans until they led us in the final for so long.
Yeah, and I think undoubtedly we were favourites, as you were saying, Adrian. And I remember a member of the eight coming up to me the day before the final saying, "You're so lucky. All you've got to do is turn up and you'll win." You know,
who said that?
I'm not sure I should say. Someone from the eight.
Yeah, it's not quite that straightforward.
Yeah.
So what are your memories of the race? I mean, Ian can play the race whilst we're doing this, but what are your memories of the race then?
I think we ought to
talk about the heat first, because didn't quite go according to plan.
Yeah, okay.
What I distinctly remember from the heat more than anything else was that the Americans got in front of us, and we had a very vague race plan. It was nowhere near as detailed as people's are nowadays. But the crucial thing in that plan was that I was going to call a really big push at 1,000 meters, and then that would set us up for the second half of the race. And in the heat, at exactly the time when I'm calling that really big push, two American jets came overhead. I think they were Navy, and they did a sort of fly past about 100 meters over our heads, so loud that the crew didn't actually hear me give that call for the push at all. So I had to call it again. And we went through the Americans and we beat them by, I think it was about a length in the end. But when we go off the water, that was when I said to Martin, I would actually prefer if he gave the pushes, the calls, in the final, partly because I was a little bit nervous about having that responsibility, and partly because that from a sort of psychological point of view, I figured that if he was calling the pushes, it would have more impact for the whole of the crew than if I was calling it from a position of lying down in the bows doing nothing. We never rehearsed it, but that's the way that it worked in the final. And it worked really well.
I think what you really mean is if Martin called it, he might do it.
He might do it, yeah.
Yeah.
Then he might argue that when he called it, eventually somebody else might join in.
Yeah, it was such a shock when Mark called it. I didn't know about this conversation, and suddenly called it. Oh my God, we better go now.
Do you remember the start we got in that heat?
Yeah, so why did the first two not work then?
I remember the Americans talking about it because they're absolutely convinced that we cheated.
Yeah. It was great when
we had to do it. Been watching the video, weren't we?
Yeah. When you used to have to start with Et vous pray parte, and you'd sort of be on the start and it was, you know, Et vous pray, and you'd be moving the blade, you'd have to gauge when to jump the start. It's got really boring now, hasn't it? everyone waits for it. But we got a fantastic squeeze on that start.
In the heat.
I can't remember anything of the heat apart from the jets and the start. And I can't remember rowing back through the Americans.
I think we went through them very quickly. So when I called that push the second time, there was a really big response. And we went from, I guess it was half length down to half length up in about 20 strokes. And then we just kept moving away, you know, almost like they'd given up. But then having spoken with Ed Ives since then, he's become quite a good friend of mine. He was the American stroke. And he basically blamed it all on their equipment, as he would, you know, saying that because they were on a very high gearing, hard gearing, they couldn't change rate. And they were also using wooden blades, so they didn't have the flexibility that we did with the Dreiserkackers. But then, you know, you could argue, well, he would say that, wouldn't he?
Well, I don't know why it didn't bloody work in the final. But we didn't go through them that quickly in the final.
Were they ready for it, weren't they?
Yeah.
Yeah. They knew our race plan.
So in the final, the plan was that we were going to just jump off the start and lead and dominate and control the race right from the very beginning. And it just didn't happen at all like that. So we kind of had to improvise, and that's where Martin's experience really came in, that he called the pushes at the time when we were expecting them to be, but nothing really happened until the last one.
I don't know, there's some music with this race that we did lead off the
through it, can't you?
We did lead off the first few strokes, didn't we?
Yeah,
not for very long though.
So we're definitely up there. Like, we're killing the New Zealanders. Like,
yeah, the Kiwis were just never in it. From my perspective, I just remember it being a two-horse race right from the very, very start. I never even saw any of the other boats.
Yeah. But we were supposed to lead, weren't we? The race plan was that we were going to lead the Americans and then push away from them.
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't think there was much of a race plan, because if you remember the night before, we had that meeting with Mike, and there was yet another one of those little arguments between Martin and Mike, because basically Mike was saying, well, you know what to do, there's nothing really to say. And Martin said, no, we do need to discuss it. We need to talk about, you know, what we're going to do if this situation happens and what we're going to do if this situation happens. So we did actually have a bit of a talk about it.
Yeah. I think Mike said,
I don't recall that we actually discussed what we were going to do if we were down, because we never thought it was going to happen.
They're a long way up there, aren't they? Is that 500?
Yeah. Can you remember what was going through your head, Martin, at this point? Because you're the nearest of us, four of us.
Yeah. I must have been partly because the Americans led us in the heat. I just assumed. So I think I assumed that we would go back through them.
But yeah, nothing, now. Yeah.
Yeah, but nothing we did seemed to make a difference. And the longer the track went down, the more it was like, you know, why aren't we going through? Because basically, you know, when we call a burn or a push or something, that's when we respond. And the other thing, so I remember calling, but I just remember why aren't we moving?
So you called three times. You called at 1,000 metres and nothing happened. Because I remember I was telling you I'm level with the American stroke's feet. And I was saying that sort of every 30 seconds, just to let you know exactly where we were. So at 1,000 metres, you called the push. And I said, I'm still level with his feet.
This is coming into the last 500, isn't it?
Yeah, 750 to go, you called it again. And I think we moved sort of half a seat, but then they responded. And then the last call was at 500 to go. And, you know, to this day, 36 years later, I remember the note of desperation in your voice. It was different from the previous two. And we just took off. And it was like somebody had flicked a switch or a turbocharger had kicked in. And we really started moving. And I, after about five strokes, I was saying, I'm now level with the three man. And I looked back to make sure I was steering straight and then looked back at the Americans. And I'd missed being level with two. And I said, I'm now level with Bow. I'm now level with Cox. And then we were ahead.
Yeah, I always remember that shout you gave, Mark.
What do you remember about that last 500, Steve?
I always knew that we had such a turn of pace at the end of it that we could move. And I there was never any doubt in my mind that we were going to win that race. And even though that we were down, when I saw this a few weeks ago, first time for a very long time, I was surprised of how far down we were and the length of time we were down, because that's not how I remember it in my mind.
Is it not?
No.
I think we spent virtually all of the middle 1,000 exactly half a length down on them. Because I remember, because I wasn't calling any pushes or anything, and there was very little that I was doing to help you technically, because I didn't feel competent to make it.
You can see that from the rowing.
I just remember saying I'm level with the American stroke's feet virtually from a minute into the race until that last push. So that was easily 1,000 metres where we were exactly the same place on them.
I don't know why we didn't get through. I mean, you know, it's interesting what you say about the Americans having a tough gearing, because they weren't able to respond at the finish, but they also had that film on their boat. I wonder if that had any impact at all.
Slowed them down.
They banned it. They banned it latterly, didn't they?
Yeah. Well, Steve, you tried it with Andy, didn't you, a couple of years later in 86?
Yeah.
I remember Mike spent an entire night putting it on the boat. And then you were told that you had to take it off again.
It wasn't as bad as John Garrett, that spent all his money on buying it, putting it on their boat. At least we had a different boat to swap. They had to get the hair dryers out to get it off their floor.
I do. One thing we haven't talked about was that waiting that week in the village between the heat when we qualified, because it was it Sunday to Sunday.
Yes,
it was just and the other crews had the repechage to go through, and we just had to wait. And the tension, like Andy was saying, it was relief. I mean, when I crossed the line, I just felt relief, really.
Yeah, exactly the same. Yeah.
Did you?
Yeah. Because as I said, you know, everyone was saying we were favourites and we were expected to win. It was just, thank goodness we've managed that.
Mm. Yeah, yeah.
Mm.
I can remember lying back onto Andy's feet and just thinking, well, thank God for that. We did what we set out to do and what we felt that we could do. It wasn't really an elation or anything. It was just a sort of a big sigh of relief. Mm-hmm. And then I struggled to get back up. Andy had to help me push back to up, because my stomach muscles had gone completely as well.
Yeah.
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 What made you guys so fast then? Why were you such a fast crew?
Stephen.
With the right backup.
I think personally that it was because every single one of the four in that boat who were moving it, not me, but the other four, every single one of them wanted to prove that he was better than the other three all the time. So it was very, very competitive within the boat. that nobody was willing to let anybody else sort of become dominant and become a leader. And one of the weird things about that boat, and my memory might be slightly wrong here, but from the day that that boat was put together, every single time that we went afloat, I never once had to say, right, ready to row from backstops, paddling light, go, because they just started. And it was usually Steve who started. And it was kind of like psychological thing. I'm going to be faster and, you know, more ready than everybody else. And of course, Andy would always immediately go with him to show that he was as ready, as tough. Budge had no option but to go because he was in the tandem behind Andy. And Martin had the same mentality. It was just, I never once called paddling light go. And it just became part of that crew's moxie, if you like. It was weird. I never recognized it at the time, but in hindsight, I just felt it's just so competitive within that boat. And it always was, every single outing.
I don't remember that at all. And the only thing I can put it down to was not a sort of an ego of proving it, is that I was used to being in a single scull and nobody tells you what to do. You just paddle away.
But we were the three strokes of those pairs that were in that boat who'd been honed through, you know, training against each other that winter, and Steve, who'd been, you know, playing his own furrow and racing us in the single. And so I think you're right, Adrian, there was a bit of, you know, proving to each other in the crew. You know, I think probably, was I at my peak then, sort of 27, 28? Physically, no, I don't.
It was Indianapolis. Was it when you were at your peak, Martin?
What a race that was! Yeah, 37.
The last world championship race, wasn't it?
Ever? Yeah, it was. Yeah, with you. Yeah, I got happy memories of that race. Yeah,
winners.
Very, very happy memories of that race. The medal ceremony at go on, Adrian.
I was just going to say about the power. I was always an explosive athlete. My weakest part has always been the endurance side of the sport. I was always being able to move a boat very quickly for a short period of time. And so when I was, most of the boats I've rowed in have always been very quick off the start. Andy is very smooth and probably of smoother than any of us within the boat. Budge has just got tremendous levers, and if you can set up the boat for him, he can shovel down a lot of work. And Martin had the process of would always look to be working hard in the first half, but would always wait for the last 500 meters. He always got a kick about rowing somebody down on the line. Yeah. And when Grand he put his mind to it, then could turn the gears. So the combination of all those elements was why the boat speed could suddenly change.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I think you're right. When you expressed that, you realised.
Didn't they? He's taught the cross factor.
The cross factor, yeah. Yeah.
That came later. Yeah.
That was the start. Well, could have been the start of the cross factor. No, you used to do that in your coxes four as well.
Yeah. The medal ceremony was fun. I couldn't, you know.
I think the only person smiling was Adrian. The rest of us were too knackered to.
Well, Steve was still recovering from being sick.
I was in bits.
And I remember hearing, I think it was Martin's mum. And I think possibly Steve's parents as well, but definitely Martin's mum. I remember hearing them singing along to the national anthem and not singing particularly tunefully, which was amusing in itself. But as we were standing there looking up at the flag going up and the national anthem was playing, this is halfway through the Olympics. So we'd spent the whole of the first week watching everybody else winning medals on the television to help pass time, you know, all the gymnasts and swimmers and stuff like that. And it was obviously obligatory to burst into tears when you were winning your Olympic gold medal. And I'm standing there just so happy, especially with relief rather than, you know, the elation of winning. But like Budge said, it's relief And I'm so happy with that relief. And I'm standing there looking at the anthem and looking at the flag and thinking I'm supposed to be crying my eyes out, and I just can't. I'm just too happy. So I start smiling just as the camera comes down a couple of feet onto me from Steve. And everyone thinks I'm looking smug. I suppose I was.
It's a moment, isn't it? Because British rowing has won a gold medal every Olympics since then, but hadn't won a gold medal since 48.
Yeah, it was. It was
okay. There's lottery funding came later on, but before that, what was the difference? Was it because it was a squad structure, or was it just more confidence then came to all the athletes because you guys showed it was possible?
Mm-hmm. Well, at the beginning it was Steve and Andy, wasn't it? Because in '96, the only gold medal for Team GB was you and Andy, wasn't it?
Yeah,
Budge. No, that was Steve and Budge. Steve and Matt.
Matt, yeah.
In '96.
Oh, you're right. Sorry.
I think, it's interesting because history changes the way that you look at past events. So, you know, for that Olympiad in '84, it was the first British gold in rowing since 1948. And then as the Olympiads went on and Steve was successful with Andy in Seoul and then with Budge in Barcelona. Budge, I'm giving you more Olympic medals than you deserve there.
I'll take it.
It then became known as that was Steve's first Olympic gold. So it morphed into a different thing as Steve amassed the total of five gold medals, which is interesting, really. I think he says as a historian.
Yeah, and it does give it a special place, doesn't it, in the history? Exactly as you said, Adrian, the first one since 48, and then the first one of Steve's five, and ever since, it's quite a watershed. Yeah, and it's interesting to wonder why.
Yeah.
I don't think any of us were aware of the significance on the day, though, because couldn't look forward into the future to say this is going to be the first of so many, but it did feel very special.
Yeah.
And how much is that? How much is confidence? Because up till then, you always just believed. I remember we interviewed your other crew, Martin, the 80 guys, and they very much race plan for the final was like, we can't beat the first two crews. We're going to race to consolidate our bronze. Whereas basically from that point forward, there was no, it feels like, well, Steve, I guess in your crews initially, but just generally, you guys, you believed you could beat those people now.
I don't know if it was arrogance. I don't think I always felt that I was never arrogant, but I was always confident in my ability of what I felt that I could do. From a very early age, I felt that I could be an Olympic gold medalist. Didn't find rowing until 76 and got pretty good results throughout most of my younger ages within domestic rowing. And I just felt it was my destiny in some ways that I would win an Olympic gold medal. But I thought it was going to be in Seoul in 88. Bitterly disappointed that didn't go to the Moscow Games, which we'd made in the quad scale that I was in that year, made the qualifying times, but didn't go because of the boycott of those games. So my plan from a relatively sort of 16, 17 year old was to go to three Olympics, Moscow as experience, probably in the quad scale, then move into a double for LA and hopefully be in a final pushing for a medal. And then the single for 88 to win my gold, and that was going to be it. And then the disappointment of not going to Moscow, and then suddenly finding yourself in a crew that becomes favourite and firm favourites to win. I can remember being on the start of that race and looking across, because now you're seeded into your positions. In those days, it was drawn, so we were in lane two because of the draw, not because of us winning our heat. Yeah. And I remember looking across and thinking, well, I'm 22. One of these boats are going to be Olympic champion. And my honest thought was, well, if it doesn't happen today, I've still got four more years to get it right next time. And where everyone says, oh, athletes really have positive thoughts, mine was very quite negative on the start of that race. But soon as the roll call happened and the buzzer went and off we charged. It wasn't the buzzer; it was Evu Prey, as Martin said earlier. Then you forget about that. Just the racing instincts take over.
Yeah, everyone remembers the bloody mist, don't they?
Mm. Yeah.
Oh. People that watch the race, they say, "Oh, the four coming out of the mist."
Yeah. So you can see that in the video. Yep, it was great.
You've all gone on to do quite different things. What does this gold medal mean to you guys? Because obviously nowadays there's a lot more that comes with a gold medal because there's more in the media and you know all that kind of stuff and money. But what has it meant to you guys in your lives? And did it open any doors at that point?
I don't know for me actually. I don't know because I was a teacher anyway, and there was, you know, the lovely kind of bits of publicity at home. You know, you get to be the local sort of starting fun runs to raise for Hampton Pool, and you know, do an assembly at school. I think probably one of the nicest things in retrospect though was doing an assembly on the Olympics at Hampton School, and both Greg, who was a first year, and Johnny, who was like a fourth year or something, that I taught both of them, and thinking, you know, oh, there's my teacher with Olympic gold medal, and you know, I'm taller than him, so if he can do it, you know, so I can, you know, I think that was really nice. But I remember feeling disappointed that we didn't get recognised, I guess, in terms of, you know, sporting honours. And that there wasn't more, you know, I kind of had this. Well, yeah, I kind of had
get anything
thing
from Thatcher, did we? Because of the boycott.
No,
that was irritating.
I thought Hertz would ring us up when we got home and each offer us like a BMW or Mercedes. I was like, none of that happened.
No.
So Adrian, you're saying that there was no New Year's honours because of the boycott?
Yeah, well, I think that was it. It was Thatcher's government. Yeah. And I think that that year, no gold medalists got MBEs or anything like that, whereas it was traditional to give MBEs to Olympic gold medalists.
I think it became so. As Team GB began to win more medals, it became more accepted. I don't remember being surprised that, you know, we didn't all get an MBE at the time, but I wasn't really expecting that. But my memory is sitting on the start, and normally I would calm myself down on the start of a race by thinking, this is just a rowing race, it's not the end of the world, it's not going to change your life, but realizing that actually, you know, winning Olympic gold medal probably would change my life. And in my case, unlike Martin, it did, because undoubtedly I've been in the Olympic movement ever since. Now I live in Lausanne in Switzerland with the IOC. So it has been transformative. And I'm sure it's totally changed Steve's life.
Very much so. That I knew of all our Olympic gold medalists up until that time. And they were household names, maybe not Malcolm Cooper. But he ended up repeating gold medal again 4 years later in Seoul. But of Steve Ovett, of all the names, Alan Wells from the Moscow era, of the ones that won in Montreal, I knew, and they were household names. Yeah. And I felt that suddenly we were one of these household names. And if you remember the open top bus through Marlow, you all came along to, is that I just felt that I wasn't going to be able to walk down my own home high street because I was going to get mobbed because of this Olympic gold medal that I had. And the reality, it wasn't at all. And on that day of the open top bus, is that there were people shopping and they were sort of looking up at the bus and thinking, well, what's going on here type of thing? And people saying to me sort of a few months afterwards as well, what do you do? And I said, well, I row. And they said, oh, who do you row for, Oxford or Cambridge? And I said, well, I've actually won an Olympic gold medal. Oh, you must have trained really hard for that the last 2 months leading into it. And you say, well, actually, that's the easier bit of it. of that. And then by the end of my career, it completely didn't have the open top buses through Marlow of the other ones, but there was for the Sydney one, and it was absolutely packed, absolutely unbelievable of how the sport and the impact, and the people who like sport knew about the Olympics. I think in that period of time of the 80s and 90s is that the Olympics became much bigger, and certainly bigger within in the UK. Yeah. And that where I thought I was going to be one of these sort of megastars and everything was going to fall at your feet. And the reality is that nothing really changes. Nothing really changes, but everything has changed.
Yeah.
I had this thing for a long time of feeling, you know, like I suppose the easiest way to describe it is like I wasn't a proper Olympic gold medalist, like somebody who was famous, like, say, Steve Overt or Seb Coe, because I was never very good at sports at school. And I think in the way that, you know, the mind works, I'd kind of created like a tier level of Olympic medalists, of people like Cohen, Ovett and Daley Thompson, and then me. And it was very unhealthy, I think, for me and my psyche to do that, which I kind of, it took me quite a while to get over that, really. Considering how hard we'd all work for it and how hard I'd put into it. So I had a very interesting relationship with the actual physical gold medal thing, which basically my dad looked after. It used to be my mum and dad's house, and I've got it now. But I kind of now, when I look at the gold, it's the thing I have left about my dad, really. It reminds me, because my dad was so chuffed with it, that the gold medal, you know, I look after it because it's the sort of leftover of my dad who passed away in 2004. So I have a very interesting relationship with the actual sort of, you know, physical thing of the medal.
It was quite interesting, Steve, you were saying about people bumping into you. A few people you speak to, that when they get a gold medal, they meet somebody in the street, they say, oh, can I see your gold medal? I've never seen a gold medal before. And I remember one athlete saying to me, said, well, and I said to the person, well, you've never met an Olympic gold medalist before. It's not the medal, it's the person. And
yeah,
it's how the people who watch it think about the gold medal, but actually for the athletes, it's what you've achieved. The gold medal just happens to be lying on the table. Does that sound fair?
Matthew was always very good at describing the process. Is that the medal is sort of the badge of honour in some ways, but it's knowing what you've done and what you've achieved, which is the important thing about it. And in some ways, he's exactly right. And so when I used to go to lots of functions and take the medals around, because people just get so much joy out of seeing it, touch it. Oh, can I really touch it? Can I touch it?
Yeah.
And that gives you a kick from them getting excited about something that you may have been part of, but then that spinning off in possibly in their life and pointing them in maybe in a different direction to where they're going. But it always seemed separate. I think I was one of the good things about of my career sort of expanding from that point is that I've sort of, yes, I've done that. Now it's time for the next one and move on to the next thing. So when it came to Sydney, everyone was saying, especially media, oh, what's it like going for 5 gold medals? I wasn't going for 5 gold medals. Yeah. I was going for a gold medal that I hadn't got.
Yeah.
It just happened to be 5 by the end of it. It didn't really matter what happened before. It was what's happened next. And sort of not dwelling on the past and looking to the future. And now I've got to the age, as I said earlier, that another one that's just had a birthday, Budge, is that I'm only the only one that's just in their 50s.
Yeah.
And now I wish I could have it all over again and I've rerun it all.
We did have, Adrian, we had a reprise of R4, didn't we, 2 years later in the Commonwealth Games. Which Budge had retired then. Too soon probably. But we rode with Adam Clift in that, and I think Mostyn Field has put the race recently up on YouTube, and I remember looking back on it and thinking there were some real names in the crews that we raced and beat then.
We beat the Kiwis, didn't we, who then went on to win the gold medal in the World Championships.
No, they won silver. They got silver in behind the East Germans that year, yeah. But the we raced like Jimmy Tompkins and Mick Mackay in the Australians, you know, who were right up there.
They went on to win the 8 that year and then became the awesome foursome.
Yeah.
Winning 2 Olympic gold medals together.
Yeah. Our 4 that year, the 86 4, was really good. It was 2 pairs that, you know, just were put together by Mike Spracklen. And I remember there was the politics about whether or not you were going to race the Coxed 4 or the Coxed Less 4. So there was quite a lot of politics involved that year in what you were going to end up doing. But I remember just feeling so privileged to be in that boat because it was just felt so good.
So what's the impact, Mike? Obviously, Mike's a great coach and he's coached medals in every country. But what was Mike's influence on you guys and on the beginnings of British rowing winning?
Oh, it's massive, really.
For me personally, because he coached me from juniors, of a few weeks before going to the junior championships in 79, and then coaching Adam Clift and myself in the double the following year as our last year of juniors, then through of all the sculling squad years, then through the 4, and then with Andy, Mike was everything. From my hometown, or I should say I was from his hometown, that there was a very, very close bond. But without Mike, I would have never achieved anything like I have achieved, would never have got my foot on the ladder to be able to start my career as the way it was. He is a bizarre character, as we all were in a very different ways. He was very, very single-minded, and a lot of his sort of the early years of spending with him, some of that has rubbed off on me of being a perfectionist, even though I'm not a perfectionist. Is that if I do something, I try to do it to my best ability. The problem is I can't do it perfectly.
Yeah,
I remember Mike being very demanding as a coach. No, he, like Steve says, he was a perfectionist. And I think that he improved the compatibility of the crew in a way that nobody else would have done. And he was very demanding and set very high standards, which I think we sort of all rose up to that level under his tutelage. And we ended up, you know, being a lot better as a result of that than we had been under other coaches previously.
Yeah, I'm not sure if we'd have been as successful without Mike. You know, you think of the other coaches that were around at the time, and that they didn't have the X factor that Mike had.
No, nobody else would have got us all together in the first place.
Yeah.
The coaches were around at that time. Yeah. And that was one of, I think, one of the best elements of Mike, is that he was able to see something in somebody well before anybody else saw it or could do it. So he knew that Andy was good, that and what Budge could do. Obviously, I'd spent a lot of time with Mike anyway, but of racing a brain Martin and being part of that. And he was able, as Adrian said, as sort of pulling it all together. And even though we had very different reasons for doing what we did, he was able to blend that together and start Britain on this amazing run, British rowing on this amazing run of golds at the Olympics.
It's interesting. Steve, do you think that Mike psychologically challenged you and Andy in later years in the way that he challenged certainly Martin, among others, probably in 84? Because there was a lot of sort of psychological needling from Mike, which was totally deliberate, but definitely brought out the best in people in 84.
Yeah, it's an interesting one. Is that I think by the time Mike went to Canada, is that we'd run our course together. We'd learned so much together. Yes, he was a successful coach before I started rowing with him and winning world championships and Olympic medals. But we went on a journey together. Had a lot of failure, but some success as well. And by the time we sort I started rowing with Simon before Matthew came on board and he went off to Canada, is that we're still very, very close friends but we'd run our course together. It was time to go into different directions.
Well, guys, thank you very much for your time. It's been really interesting just listening to us, trying to how much fun you guys had together, even though you've not really done that much together since. But really, thanks for your time. It's been amazing.
Yeah,
we never got to the stories of the car breaking down in San Diego on our training camp, and Bud's getting all upset because he couldn't get his lunch, and we all got out of the car and Budge marched off, and we all chatted at him. He came back, and then when we did get the car back to the center, and we all went off to lunch, he said, "Oh, it's too late now. I've missed my lunchtime."
He's really regular. He likes his meals regular, Budge.
Yeah, he's hangry.
I think what we all got out of that crew is that we started off that journey with a kind of animosity towards each other for various reasons that Martin's talked about already. But by the time we finished that particular combination on the day that we won the Olympics, because we never got back in the boat again since that, with all five of us in the boat. But we've all become very, very good friends. And there's just infinite respect and friendship and admiration for each other. And that was all come out of that melting pot of what we went through, particularly in the winter, 82, 83, learning just how competitive each of the other guys were. There just weren't any weak links in that boat, except maybe me. You know, and to this day, I don't know how I got in that boat because there was a vote, and I don't know whether all four voted for me or whether it was 3-1 or even, you know, it split and then one of the coaches made a decision. I don't know, and I don't want to know. I'm just grateful that I was there, and it was a fantastic journey for me, and I'm forever grateful to everybody else who was involved in it.
I always remember the San Diego training camp that you'd been out to a bar the night before.
Oh, yeah.
And you never admitted that you fell asleep in the boat. Now seeing us row and see how rough we were, there was no way that you would have been able to fall asleep of our rowing. But I'm still convinced you fell asleep in that that session.
I'm pretty sure I did, yeah.
Thanks for putting it together, Adrian.
Yeah, thank you.
We really enjoyed it.
Really good. Okay, we'll end the live portion of the broadcast now.